I will present how these meetings work. So welcome everybody to this new session of QRST seminars. As you know, this meeting is being recorded and will be uploaded in our YouTube channel. And all the information about these meetings can be found in our Twitter account or following us in Eventbrite, so you can check when will be the next meeting. So today we have Tobias Howe from the Imperial College of London and Ian McCormack from University of Chicago. And we will start with Tobias. So maybe I stop sharing while I present you. So Tobias is a researcher at Imperial College London and graduated PhD student at the Center for Quantum Technologies in Singapore. And previously he had been staying at NTT in Japan and the University of Catania in Italy. He received his master from the University of Erlangen in Germany, and his research interests lie at the intersection of quantum computing, quantum simulation, and artificial intelligence. Recently, he proposed together with his collaborator Kishore Bharti a new generation of NISQ algorithms, as well as method to enhance variational quantum algorithms, and the thing that he will present today, the quantum-assisted eigensolver and simulator. So the floor is yours, Toby. Welcome.
Hey, thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much for the kind introduction, Alba. As you nicely mentioned, so today I'm going to talk about the quantum-assisted eigensolver and simulator. So as I said, this work was done in conjunction with Kishore Bharti. So he's from my collaborator. He's from the Center of Quantum Technologies in Singapore, so the place where I did my PhD. And so let's jump right into it. Okay, so as you may all know, quantum computers bring us hope that we can basically use them to solve problems which are hard for classic computers. So one example would be like the Shor algorithm. So these are like problems. The quantum computers give us hope that we could solve problems which are not possible to address with classic computers. Problems, of course, sadly, the quantum computers that are available right now in experiment by, let's say, IBM, Google, D-Wave, and so forth, they're not fault-tolerant computers. So in fact, they're quite noisy, like the individual systems are prone to noise. We have only a limited number of qubits, so in the range of 50 to hundreds. And additionally, like if any error occurs during the operation, we cannot correct the error right now. However, John Preskill proposed that even with these current computers, there may be actually something already useful you can do. And he coined this term noisy intermediate scale quantum or short NISQ algorithms. So he said, like, even with these kind of noisy computers, is there something useful we can do? And there is some hope. So for example, Google, as well as recently also in China, Zhang-Wei Pan, they used their quantum computer to solve a certain problem, which they say is hard for classical computers. Although these problems were kind of not relevant in terms of, like, let's say, economic sense, like they still show it's possible to do something which is out of reach for classical computers on the current quantum hardware. So this gives us hope that we can now maybe use these NISQ computers to solve problems already which are hard for classical computers. For example, like we can use the current NISQ quantum computers to simulate a quantum system. We can use them for optimization or, let's say, solve nonlinear equations. And for this has spawned a hot field right now, the field of noisy intermediate scale quantum algorithms. And we have in January, a review came out basically by the Alan Aspoguzi group and the group from Quek in Singapore. And in this review, he reviewed the whole field of NISQ. And as you can see from the contents list here, I'm not going through it, it's way too much. So you can see there's a gigantic amount of things and a gigantic amount of applications that has been spawned in the NISQ, field. And you can see the review has over 60 pages and I think several hundred citations. So you can see there's a gigantic interest in this field. And there's a lot of hope and promise what you can do. And I'm gonna now introduce one of the main NISQ algorithms that people use, the variational quantum algorithm. And after that, I'm going to basically propose our new generation of algorithm, the quantum assisted one. So the variational quantum algorithm, the idea is basically you have a quantum circuit, which is composed of quantum gates that you apply in qubits. And these quantum gates are parameterized by some angle theta. So you apply this and you generate some quantum state. And then you take this quantum state and you measure, let's say, the energy of some Hamiltonian H. And then the idea is now you want to change the parameters theta of this quantum circuit such that you minimize the energy And if you find them there, if you optimize this long enough, eventually you will reach the ground state, and you will find the ground state wave function corresponding to this Hamiltonian H. So how this algorithm proceeds is by running a quantum classical feedback loop. So the idea is as follows. You will start with a quantum computer with certain parameters theta. You produce the states, and then you perform measurements. The measurements being you measure the, let's say, the Hamiltonian energy, the energy of the Hamiltonian. And you use the outcome of the measurement that you have done on this quantum computer and feed it to a classic computer. And the classic computer is running an optimization routine and spits out a new set of parameters that you feed into your quantum computer. And then you repeat this game back and forth, and the classic computer will hopefully find better and better thetas that minimize your energy. However, as you can see, this is some kind of a feedback loop. So this is some kind of iterative processing, meaning while the quantum computer is running, you have to wait until it's finished before you can send the data to a classic computer. And once the classic computer is finished, you send back to the quantum computer. So while the quantum computer is doing something, you have to wait. And this is this can be an issue on the current quantum hardware, which is in the cloud. So to give you an example, like IBM has a certain number of quantum computers that are available for use, some of them for free. And if you want to run something quantum, you just send the job to them. So you send them on the internet, you send the job to them, and they will run it for you. However, they're quite popular, as you can tell. So I plotted a few days ago, I went to their website and checked how popular they are. And you can see, like, to give an example, like this machine called Melbourne has 16, well, it has currently 15 qubits, and the number of jobs is over 7,000. So 7,000 different jobs are to be run on this machine. So as you can immediately see, it may take a while until like your job is finished because you have to wait in queue and basically wait before the other jobs is finished before your own job can run. And once that happened, you have to go back, send the output to the classic computer, and then again, submit a new job with the new set of parameters. And then again, you have to queue and wait until like everyone else is finished and your job is ready to go and so forth. And since often this algorithm may take like hundreds or thousands of iteration steps, you can immediately see it may take a while until like you finish all these iterations, given these kind of long queue waiting times. Another issue that people like find with variational quantum algorithms is the Baron plateau problem. So that one is regarding if you have a randomized parameterized quantum circuit, it turns out that if you update the parameters and you calculate the gradient of the parameters to update them, it turns out the gradient vanishes exponentially with the number of qubits. So the more qubits you have, the slower the variance. And similar feature also appears for noise, for entanglement. Gradient-free methods have the same issue, and also the quantum natural gradient. At this point, I just want to shortly shout out, we've done a recent paper where we looked at this quantum natural gradient and also the capacity of quantum circuits. So the reference is below. So I urge you to check it out when we study these kind of variational quantum circuits as well. But another issue I want to talk about is the Hadamard test. So if you want to measure something on a quantum computer, for certain types of algorithms, you need something called, you need to measure an overlap. This is needed, for example, for the so-called variational quantum simulator, which is used to simulate quantum dynamics. And these overlaps, I plotted two of them here below. This is the C and A thing. These are not observables. So the outcome has both a real part and a complex part. And to measure them, you need something called a Hadamard test, which is the circuit is shown below, which basically it requires an additional qubit ancilla and a controlled unitary operation, where the control sits on the ancilla and the unitary is applied on the circuit itself. And these kind of measurements, Hadamard tests, they're quite expensive in terms of gates. So to realize the control unitary on quantum hardware requires quite a substantial number of gates. And on the current hardware, you would like to avoid this because the more gates you have, the more noise prone you are. So these Hadamard gates is something you would like to avoid if possible. So with these kind of things in mind, we proposed a new generation of algorithm called the quantum assisted simulator, as well as the quantum assisted eigensolver. And you can use the algorithm to approximate the ground state of a Hamiltonian and solve the Schrödinger equation. They also have other uses, but I'm going to shortly introduce those uses later on. And this algorithm we propose is a proposed of three distinct steps. So in the first steps, you generate an ansatz made of so-called hybrid states, which can be done in a systematic fashion. Then once you do that, you send those states and you perform measurements on a quantum computer. So once you finish the measurement on the quantum computer, you do some classic post-processing on your classic computer. So one of the neat things of this algorithm is that there's no feedback loop. So once you have generated these answered states, you just send them directly to the computer and there's no need to go back to the quantum computer. Once the computations are finished on the quantum computer, you're done. There's no need to go back and forth, back and forth. It's just one run on the quantum computer and you're finished. There's a system made of generating ansatz. There's no Baron plateau problem since we circumvented by having no gradients. And we do not require a Hadamard test to evaluate our circuits. Okay, so how does it work? So first of all, let's go through the three steps one by one. So as first, we need to generate an ansatz. And we do something which we call hybrid states. It's pretty much a linear combination of quantum states, which is shown here with this here. And you see it's the quantum state phi is parameterized as a sum over a set of quantum states, each given with a certain classical parameter alpha and the state psi. And you apply in the state psi, you apply some unitary ui. And each alpha I, each component of this is characterized by has some specific ui. So there's a set of unitaries ui, which you apply in some quantum states. And for each of them, you give some classical coefficient alpha. And this idea is very much like similar to the idea of linear combination of atomic orbitals, which is a well-known method in quantum chemistry, where you superimpose two different or several atomic orbitals together to create like antibonding and bonding molecular orbitals. So the concept is quite similar. However, in our case, we say these parameters alphas for each of the quantum states is stored on the classical computers, whereas the state psi itself is prepared on the quantum computer. So basically we share both classic and quantum part. And this is why we coined as a hybrid state. And it has been shown that this alpha can be optimized free of Baron plateaus. And I would like to mention that this kind of ansatz is actually a divergent ansatz is actually a special case of it. So namely, when you only have one of these alpha terms, you go back to the original, normal divergent ansatz. But for now, we're just gonna look at what happens if you have many of those alpha parameters, so many different combination states, and we drop for now the theta. So we'd say we keep theta fixed and we only think about optimizing alpha for now. Okay, so how do we generate these kind of ansatz states? So the way we chose is we do some ansatz which is inspired by imaginary time evolution. So it works as follows. So in imaginary time evolution, you evolve your state psi with a non-unitary operator given by exponential of minus ht, where h is the Hamiltonian and t is the time. And on the right side, you see a graph where I plot basically the energy of Hamiltonian under imaginary time evolution against time. And you can see the blue line, which gives the energy over time, converges down to the ground state. In general, this is a non-unitary operation, so it's difficult to apply on the real hardware. But you can, for example, do a Taylor expansion. So you sum over the Taylor expansion of the exponential, and this gives you increasing orders of h. So first order, you have on zero order, you have identity. First order is you have h, something proportion to h. Then in second order, you have something proportion to h squared, and so forth, up to some order. And this method is very much, you can think of this method like a Kreilov subspace method. So the Kreilov subspace is a method well used in classical, on classical computers, where the idea is that you have some state psi and some Hamiltonian, and now you expanded this state psi in terms of the Hamiltonian. And you span like a linear space composed of the state psi, and you apply higher orders of h onto the state psi. And this is used as a basis expansion for, let's say, optimization tasks. So you have psi, then h psi, then h squared psi, and so forth, up to some order k that you define. And the state is then basically a sum over these different states that are generated with some coefficient alpha. This Kreilov method, however, is also difficult to apply in quantum computers because higher orders of h are quite hard to implement. So for this, we now, for our quantum assist simulator, we derive something called, we call the k-moment expansion method. So we now go back and think that the Hamiltonian H can often be expressed as a sum of unitaries ui. So we have a sum of m unitaries ui. For example, you can think of these unitaries ui as being, let's say, Pauli strings with some coefficient ci. And the cumulative chemos then are then constructed as applying these components of H onto the state psi. So the zero order being just the state psi alone. Then the second order, you apply the different UIs on the state psi, generate m different states. And then you do this also for higher orders. And the set of all these states, then you use as a basis state for your wave function. And this method is actually more general than Krylov. So the Krylov subset would be a specific subset of this method. Okay, so once you now generated these kind of states in a systematic way, inspired by imagined time evolution, you now have to go to the quantum computer. So what you need to do now, the task now is you have to measure specific overlaps. These are these E and D matrices you see here. So you would have this psi I, and the psi I are the different states we generated via this cumulative K moment states. And now we need to measure these overlaps. So psi I with psi j, as well as this D matrix with psi I overlap with H and psi j. In general, I said overlaps are difficult to handle because they are not observables. But if you now go back and think that the Hamiltonian H can be written as a linear combination of unitaries, and now assume that the unitaries are Pauli strings, so a tensor product of Pauli operators. So one example I plot here below, this P term here, this is just a tensor product of Pauli strings. So if you assume that our Hamiltonian is constructed as a linear combination of such terms, then it turns out that evaluating this E and D matrices corresponds to evaluating measurements of Pauli strings. So we have to simply measure Pauli strings. And this is something that this is bread and butter business on current quantum computers. This can be done by simple single qubit rotations and projective measurements. So there's no Hadamard test for to measure these. You can just do simple sampling from the machine. And with this, you can evaluate these E and D matrices. And once you've done that, you now have to do some classical post-processing. So let's say we have now measured our E and D matrices. And now let's say our task is to simulate let's say you want to minimize find the ground state of a Hamiltonian. So we want to minimize this observable. How we do that? So the program that turns out to be is we have to minimize alpha, where alpha is these cluster combination parameters, to the dagger times D times alpha, where D is this overlap matrix we measured before, subject to that alpha times E times alpha is equal to 1. So this minimization program turns out to be a quadratically constrained quadratic program, or QCQP for short, which is a well-defined optimization program with where you can basically prove stopping criteria, and like mathematically it's well characterized. So this program you have then to minimize, which where the like, existing solver, and it's well studied how to do it. You can also further do a relaxation of this program to a simulated program, or STP in short, which is can be solved in polynomial time and is a standard workhorse in classical optimization and well known how to do it. So this is so the optimization, finding ground state is a well-studied mathematical problem. If you want to simulate a Schrödinger equation, you have to solve this differential equation here, linear differential equation. But actually it turns out you can also convert this program by using some additional steps into a QCQP. So you can turn it into a well-defined mathematical program as well. This actually we're gonna publish or release how to do this in some time. So please keep a lookout for that. Okay, so once we've done our three steps, we're pretty much finished. Okay, so again, I want to stress that there's no quantum feedback loop here, because once we've done the measurement on quantum computer, you don't have to go back and forth between them, right? Because once you have answered states, you can just measure everything and you're finished. Okay, so one thing you can, for example, extend it to is you can extend our program also to open systems. By that, you have to go now to density matrices, which you can also define in a similar way, which you call the hybrid density matrix, where you define the state rho, the density matrix, as a linear combination of these kind of state psi I and psi j together with a parameter beta, where beta is now a classical parameter and the psi j again prepared in the quantum computer. And with this kind of hybrid density matrix, you can as well like do the same trick again as before with the three steps, and you can simulate the Lindblad master equation and do Gibbs state preparation. So you can treat open systems as well. You can also tackle with this kind of approach, you can also tackle non-linear differential equation. I'm gonna skip that for now, but this also has been shown in a recent paper of ours. And again, I want to stress, I mentioned this before, but I want to stress again that diversionary quantum algorithms are actually a special case of our quantum assisted algorithms. So they can be integrated within. And you can easily see that by seeing that we now say that this parameter, so we can now talk about how to optimize this parameter alpha, the combination state of the quantum states. But you can also optimize this parameter theta as well. The theta is the parameter that generates our quantum state. And we can also derive gradients within our framework of the quantum assisted eigensolver as well. So this would be from given like, this would tell us like given the framework of the quantum assisted eigensolver, this we can calculate the gradients, how to optimize this theta parameter. So the parameters of the quantum circuit as well. So these can be both matched together into one framework as well. So I think that's quite nice that everything can be combined together. I'm just going to show now a few examples. Just to remind you, so we have some Hamiltonian and we generate our cognitive K-mon states this way. And now we try to solve the ISI model, so some spin model with our approach. And we use some initial state psi that we prepare in quantum state, and we show like how does the ISI model, like the energy that we find, change with the moment k. Where k is like how many k moment states you basically use. And you can see like what we take different initial states like a Hahn-Riemann state, a product state, and some state optimized by QoA. And you find with increasing k, we find we go towards the ground state, so we can successfully optimize this problem. Further, I think interesting is we try the comparison between imaginary time evolution, which we use as our initial motivation for IQA, and we compare it with IQA itself. And we actually found a particular example, or this is some, in the case where the initial state psi has certain symmetries inside, it turns out that imaginary time evolution fails to find the ground state. Because if you do imaginary time evolution, it's unable to break symmetries of the initial state. So if initial state has a certain symmetry inside, which is in a different symmetry second than ground state, then the imaginary time evolution will fail to find the optimal ground state, which is on the right graph here, the orange dash curved. However, if you use IQE, we can in fact find the ground state. A reason that of course is because our cumulative K-mon state is more general. So we expand in the individual terms of the Hamiltonian, and they're able to break the symmetry of the problem, and therefore we are able to find the ground state where imaginary time evolution is unable to. We also ran a short example on the IBM machine where we compare different NISQ algorithms and see how they perform on a time-dependent Hamiltonian, which we show here. So we compared the three main simulation algorithms for time evolution of Hamiltonians. So we tried the Trotter decomposition where you take the unitary revolution and decompose it into small discrete steps, which you repeatedly apply on the quantum state. Then we did the variational quantum simulator, which does some variational approach to simulate the dynamics. And we used our quantum assisted simulator. So you can see the results taken from the IBM machine below. So let's take a look first at the orange curve, the orange dots. This is the Trotter approach. As you can see, Trotter, the red curve shows the classically obtained values. That is the exact solution of this problem. This is the red curve. And if the orange dots shows your Trotter, and you see Trotter is initially doing quite well, but then you see the oscillations are decaying. Reason for that is for longer times, Trotter needs more circuits to simulate. So the longer the time evolution, the more circuits Trotter needs. And more circuits means, of course, you have more noise, because the longer the circuit, the more noise will affect it. So this causes this decay of the oscillation. For the variational quantum simulator in blue, you see that there's something peculiar going on. The oscillation frequency is somehow like too short. So we see that the period becomes longer than it's what's supposed to be. And this is some effect of the noise. So if you remove noise, it doesn't have this problem. So it seemed that noise is causing a systematic error in the evolution with the variational quantum simulator. The green curve is the quantum assisted simulator, so our method. And we see it works quite well and like reduces dynamics quite nicely. Just to mention, this work was done by Jonathan Lau from Singapore, a collaborator of ours from Craig's group. Okay, so I now come to the conclusion. So I just want to reiterate, we proposed with the quantum assisted simulator in eigensolver, we propose a three-step algorithm. The three steps are first, you generate the ansatz in a systematic way. Then you do quantum measurements. And finally, you do in the third step, you do classical post-processing. And we can do this in a systematic way using these hybrid states and the circumvent Baron plateaus. A nice feature is we do not have feedback loops. So once your answer is fixed, you just run on the quantum computer. So you only have to run one job. And once that's done, you're finished. There's no need to go back. And this is very nice on the current quantum hardware that we have, with where you have to wait in queues. And we do not require any complicated Hadamard tests or other measurement systems, but you can just do simple measurements of Pauli strings. And the optimization program that we have to run to optimize is a well-characterized QCQP, a well-characterized mathematical program, which gives us nice guarantees. Okay, so with this, I very much thank you for your attention, and thank you.
Thanks, Tobias, for this nice talk. We have some questions in the chat. Maybe we have time for a couple of them. So the first one actually is more than one question in one. It comes from Alan Aspuru. And isn't this very similar to the quantum subspace expansion of Jarrod-MacLean? What are the key differences? What happens if the ground state combines a very large number of different states? How do you know you span enough states for the solution?
Yeah. So we could find different methods from a different kind of fields. So for example, like the idea of the linear combination is similar to the subspace method, but we also add additional top. We have the systematic way of generating our unsat states. We propose like to use the mathematical way of solving the problem. And we also show how to use to adapt our program for quantum for simulation of problems. So we put the very different topics together. But yeah, some ideas were already lying around. We basically, in our algorithm, we put these different ideas together and basically expand upon them to devise this algorithm. Sorry, the second question was about the what happens if you have many terms, right?
Yeah, what happens if the ground state combines very large number of ansatz states, and how do you know if you span enough states for the solution?
Okay, so we expand our states in terms of the Krylov. So our approach is inspired by the Krylov subspace, which if you take in enough terms, you go in the right direction, that you basically span the same space as the ground state. Of course, if your ground state is very complicated, or if your initial ansatz state that you have prepared in quantum computer is not very good, then you may need many terms. So it very much depends on how much intelligence you put inside. So you need to basically you need to prepare some initial proper good initial state as well. So it's not just a universal method, but you have to put something in as well.
Okay, we have many questions, and we only have time for another one, but just to remind to the audience that after the two talks, we will stay longer with the speakers in case you want to discuss with them further questions or comments or whatever. So, and also they will continue answering them in the chat probably. So the other question is from Kunlu Zhou. What's the size complexity of the SDP matrix in terms of the system size N?
Okay, so the complexity depends on how many ansatz states you chose. So we do this cumulative K-mode expansion, and basically we'll choose a certain number of states from that. So let's say you have 10 ansatz states, then the resulting SDP, you have to solve a matrix of the size 10 times 10. So it will scale linearly with the number of ansatz states you chose. So it very much depends on how many ansatz states you put in and you pick. That's how complex your problem will be.
Okay, so sorry, but we need to switch to the other talk. And as I said, stay afterwards the meeting, or just answer the question, Toby, maybe in the chat.
I was in the chat. Okay, thank you. Let me stop sharing.